I open the meeting again into public session, and our next item of business is an evidence session as part of the committee's pre-budget scrutiny work. The purpose of the session is to inform the committee's pre-budget scrutiny with the aim of influencing the budget before spending priorities for the next financial year are set. And members will be aware we do have a budget statement the first week back after the October recess. The focus of today's session is on the cost crisis and impact on tourism and hospitality industries. I welcome Mark Crothall, who is Chief Executive of the Scottish Tourism Alliance, who is joined with Brian Simpson, Industrial Organiser, Unite Hospitality, and Leon Thompson, Executive Director of UK Hospitality. I welcome you all to the committee this morning. Can I just reflect that I think this similar panel was before us last year in advance of last year's budget, and the main call we had at that time was for investment in stage two of the Tourism Recovery Fund, a call that the committee were, that supported the government were sympathetic to and the committee were supportive of in our pre-budget scrutiny last year. That does seem like a distant memory as we face a cost of living crisis and a rise in business costs and the pressure the sector is under. So can I maybe ask if you feel the situation this year, you know, what has been the difference in the past year? Are we actually facing a more bleak situation as we go into this winter than what we did coming out of the COVID pandemic? And we come to Mark first.
Well, good morning and thank you, convener. From a business point of view, I think everybody would say we're in a worse place than we were last year, without question. The impact of the cost rises affecting business with the uncertainty of how to navigate through the challenges in front of us, and some of those are still relatively unknown and confused, as we've seen over the last few days as well, are really causing concern, not least to protect the business and invest in the business to be competitive in the future and recover strongly, be sustainable, but of course to maintain the workforce that is obviously in short supply anyway. So tough, to say the least. And we're going into the winter months again, where for many they would traditionally close anyway, but how do they bridge the gap and repay not just the direct costs that will still come through energy, but also some of the borrowings or the sizeable debt that many of them have taken on as well. So yes, worse than COVID at the moment in terms of survival. And the flip side of that, of course, is you've got a consumer base who are equally challenged with discretionary spend, and how they might choose to prioritise that. So I think the uncertainties of the sort of leisure spend in particular over the coming weeks and months over the winter period will be very much at risk. And Leon can, I'm sure, pick up on that, what some of the feedback getting from the hotel sector in particular.
Yeah, because the submission that we had from the STA, from the survey, does say that you're gravely concerned that some businesses might never reopen again. Is that, you know, do you feel that there's a higher risk of that this year than there was last year?
We've already seen businesses take the decision to repurpose, change their viability from being a hotel to becoming a residential property. I think it was reported on the BBC News last week about a number of properties in and around the Loch Lomond National Park area, where the smaller, mainly lifestyle hotel businesses have decided that actually to try and counter the costs and everything else that's on the horizon, it's better to try and, better to take an approach to come out of the sector. Obviously, the other key sector which has seen some shift as well is the self-catering sector with the short-term let licensing implementation process. Again, many of those operators have decided to basically come out of the marketplace. There are other operators that have been benefited from some of the international footfall we've had, which has been hugely welcome. But if you speak to that industry in particular, the inbound sector, their challenges have been about the number of breaks in the supply chain where, you know, there have been a disappearance of certain operators of skills who offer skill sets and provisions that are no longer there.
Now, I'll come to Leon Thompson, because Mark has outlined some of the key issues that the committee will want to explore. But if you want to reflect on where we are this year compared to last year, that would be helpful.
Yes. Good morning. Thanks for the invitation to be here today. I think as we came out of COVID, nobody could have imagined that we would be sort of, you know, facing a challenge of this scale after we felt that the worst of it was behind us. But as Mark has said, I mean, the challenges that face businesses now are much more significant even than the challenges they faced as a result of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. Businesses have been trying to move towards recovery, have been trying to sort of move back towards profitability, but we know from our own surveys that even over the course of the summer, only about a third of businesses were saying that they were trading at a profitable level. I suspect that figure has declined within the last sort of month or two as well. You've got businesses carrying debt from COVID. They've got the challenge now of the rising costs around business. We've got the cost of living crisis, which the public is facing as well. You're kind of bringing these two things together. It's a completely unsustainable situation for a great many businesses. A few months ago, we were talking in terms of inflation being a massive problem, which it remains, particularly around food and drink inflation. Then, obviously, energy costs came along and the increases there, which just dwarfed the problems that the businesses were experiencing. And the support which has come through from the UK government, which is incredibly welcome, still sees many businesses paying 200-300% more on their bills than they were even just a few months ago. And obviously this fix is a temporary fix for mm-hmm. 6 months, and we obviously need to continue those conversations with the UK government about what the targeted support will look like for hospitality beyond that. But right now, businesses are really struggling. They've got their costs they're trying to manage. They're seeing consumer confidence plummeting. Members are saying that bookings are incredibly low for autumn and winter. We're moving towards Christmas, which is obviously a massively important period for hospitality businesses. Some businesses could be looking to sort of make about a third of their money over the festive period in normal times. But right now, there's not much demand for Christmas parties and Christmas breaks and those sorts of things. And a lot of businesses are just scaling back their offer. Many businesses are considering whether they will stay open over autumn and winter, because it's just going to be too expensive to stay open, and they're not convinced that they're going to see the kinds of bookings coming through that they need as well. So businesses are having to make some very, very difficult decisions at the moment. And these are businesses which ordinarily would trade all the year round. If these businesses do close temporarily, hopefully only, over the autumn and the winter months, that's obviously kind of detrimental to the quality of experience for visitors who are around. And obviously these businesses will still have costs to bear, business rates and paying back loans and so on, but they won't have any income, any revenue at all. So it's very, very difficult and challenging times for hospitality right now. Mm.
And in comparison to last year, so when we had the pandemic, there was quite a bit of support, a different kind, went into the sector. So actually the sector was closed at that time, but there was furlough available, there was business rates relief, all other packages. Do you feel this crisis is more significant, but is the support comparable in any way?
No, not at all. I mean, beyond the energy rate support, there's not been anything announced for business. Now, we did welcome the reversal of the national insurance increase, which will put, for an average hospitality business, we give them about another £10,000 or so, back. So that's something. They can invest that back into the business. But it doesn't really go anywhere when you look at the kinds of increases in the costs that businesses are contending with just now. Mm-hmm. So UK hospitality, we're continuing to kind of make the ask of the UK government to revisit that. We really feel that it needs to be lowered again, and we'd like to see it down at 10%. We feel that that's a measure which would help businesses in the short and medium term. And similarly, business rate relief as well. And obviously from a Scotland perspective, if that can be secured, if that does come through in the UK government's budget in November, then hopefully there would be some Barnett consequentials which would benefit my members here and the wider hospitality sector. But I mean, these are the kinds of areas of support that businesses really need, but they really need it now. Mm-hmm. They can't really sort of wait for another 6-8 weeks to hear if there's going to be more support. I mean, as things stand just now, it's very difficult, if not impossible, for viable businesses to make any sensible business decisions about what they're going to do. And that's the position that a great many businesses find themselves in today.
Thank you. I'm going to bring Brian Simpson in. Members will have a number of questions that are directed to you, Brian, but if I could maybe just ask you to reflect on Liam's points that there'll be businesses who will make decisions about closing over the winter. Obviously, they employ people. What is going to be the impact of this kind of uncertainty within the sector on people who work in the sector?
Yeah, I mean, Leon and Mark are absolutely right. We are seeing, since March, really a huge reduction in footfall, which is obviously impacting the businesses and the employers, but also impacting the workers. We've been surveying our members, and a huge proportion of them are seeing a cut in hours, are seeing, in some cases, their pubs or bars particularly closing as a consequence, I think. Big Hospitality done a survey that found 7 out of 10 pubs were on the brink and would not survive Christmas. So I think pubs and bars and some restaurants are most impacted. Hotels are obviously impacted as well, but less so because of the international footfall that Mark was talking about earlier. The impact on workers is almost a double whammy, because they themselves are consumers. They themselves are being hit with, in my view, what is not a price cap on energy. £2,500 is impossible for most of our members. Their average wage being between £18,000 and £21,000 a year. That puts them in energy poverty immediately, so they cannot afford to pay those bills. So there's a double whammy whereby they're being hit by the energy, the cost of living crisis, as citizens, and then they're being hit because their businesses can no longer afford to retain them. Now, obviously, I will qualify that with a position where there are a lot of large businesses, multinationals, for example, who we believe are taking advantage of the cost of living crisis and are cutting staff anyway, or cutting hours at least. There are a lot of small businesses that make up a large proportion of the employers out there who I'm sure absolutely cannot do anything else but cut hours. We would still challenge that. We campaign against hours being cut anyway, especially if there's a contractual obligation. But bearing in mind that 20% of the sector in terms of its workforce are still on zero-hour contracts, so they have no legal right to hours, no contractual right to hours, and we are seeing them being cut back to as little as 0 or 4 hours a week, which is just completely unsustainable.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to move over to members. I remind members, if they direct the question to the member of the panel they wish to hear from, that would be helpful, and you don't have to invite all members to speak, just in case, just been thinking about the timing for the meeting, if you don't wish to. Graham Simpson to be followed by Jamie Halkow-Johnson.
Thanks, Convener, and I'll take your advice. So I think we'll start with Leon, if you don't mind. I just wonder, so what you've described, all of you actually, is a situation where costs are going up and there are fewer customers. So Mark wants in. I haven't even asked the question. But
I was going to say there has been demand, and the international demand that has been there has been very welcome. Certainly not on the scale that we need. That's to be clear on that front. And the domestic market has come, but it's been very last minute, and it's been difficult to plan around. The trouble is the balance of workforce in shorter supply, costs going up and limiting the capacity of a property to then drive the necessary yield that it needs to pay the bill. So, but the demand is now definitely, without question, falling off a cliff. And as we go into the winter, that's the challenge.
Okay. So, Leon, can you explain, in terms of costs, because I want to explore that a bit, what are the main costs that businesses are having to, or cost increases that businesses are having to deal with? I mean, we know about energy, but there's other things as well.
They're right across the board. Food and drink. We've seen inflation there of sort of, you know, up to 40% on some items. It's wage inflation as well. Businesses have had to pay more in a tight labour market to secure workers and to retain workforce. And ONS put out some stats which showed that the hospitality sector is paying 15% more on wages than it was before. We're seeing interest rates obviously going up as well. So for businesses that are carrying debt, either as a result of COVID or because they've been investing in their businesses, they're now having to pay more on that borrowing as well. So, I mean, the costs are huge, and you know, insurance is up as well, and some businesses have been sort of, you know, kind of struggling to secure insurance too. So all of those, and then obviously energy on top of that as well.
Yeah. Okay. Now you said you know, the measures by the UK government on energy was welcome, but probably not enough. Is there anything more that either of our governments could be doing?
Well, I mean, obviously I'd highlighted that from a UK government perspective, we're keen to see the VAT rate coming down. We think that would provide immediate support. Similarly, increased support around business rates relief as well. Now, businesses in England are currently enjoying sort of 50% rate relief at the moment, albeit with caps. We would certainly like to see that replicated here in Scotland as an absolute minimum. I mean, we understand the challenges, the financial challenges that the Scottish Government has at the moment, but it is one of the levers that is there for ministers. So if we can secure more money for business support from the UK Government, then we would certainly hope to see that the Barnett consequentials being used to support our businesses.
Okay. I guess a quick... Well, whoever can answer this, you're all painting a pretty grim picture, and I just wonder whether we're able to, you know, sort of put any sort of figures on that for Scotland. You know, like but Brian, you said 7 out of 10 pubs are on the brink. So that I mean, I don't know what on the brink can mean anything. But is there anything? Is there any stats that you can give us? Yeah.
There's a recent survey that's just been done by the Scottish Licensed Trade Association across 600 pubs, I think, which said one out of ten will shut for the winter. 4 out of 10 will reduce their hours significantly over the winter period. And you know, that was off the press last week. We've got a snapshot survey out at the moment around the impact of energy following the announcements from the UK government last week to get a feel and a sense of what that will mean for business closure in the short term. And let's be frank that not every business has had any benefit whatsoever from that. Anyone pre-April 1 who's signed up to a contract is not going to see that. Our chairman, Stephen Leckie, across his entire estate is one of those that won't qualify for that VAT. So it's not a broad brush approach. And the uncertainty of not knowing where you are is what's causing the challenge. And for us, I mean, if you look longer term now, and we talk about NSET and everything else, it's how do we stay competitive? You know, we have to have investment into the assets that we've got to be really, really competitive on a global stage. And not being able to invest in basic maintenance and repair of a property, but also to be appealing and attractive to that international audience that has got the pound or the dollar to spend is really, really important. So the business rates relief, and we did get the £27,000 cap, I think, in the first quarter of the year, which was very welcomed. But again, if I use Crieff Hydro as an example, their cost base is £25,000 a day or at that lowest level. So, you know, it doesn't really touch the sides when it comes to having a real impact on a broader base. But it's investment for the future in infrastructure, in the property, in the asset, and in the people. And we have to be able to find a means to do that.
Okay.
Thank you. Jamie Howell-Johnson to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much. Morning. I'll put this to Mark first and then maybe to Leon if you want to come in. It seems a little of a leading question, but the SDA have called for a pause on regulations that put increasing burdens on businesses at this time. Do you want to kind of outline some of those regulations?
Yes, thanks for the question. We were invited, in fact, collectively to enter into a conversation around putting proposals for pause or taking off the table of both existing, pending and new regulation. One of those was the implementation of the short-term licensing fee structure, the collection of, nobody had said, Fiona Campbell herself had said, it's not about taking the policy off the table altogether, it's about pausing that investment. Another one was the deposit return scheme, which I think for many is still a bit of an unknown, but also up front there's a sizable investment required by operators length and breadth of the country of different shapes and sizes, upfront investment. Could that be paused as well? There were other suggestions around the implementation of the 20p supplement on disposable cups from coffee shops, etc., which was largely to try and deflect a pause in consumer purchasing, and you know, it's another cost on top. And the transient visitor levy, of course, which has been committed to in the programme for government, we think the sentiment piece around that is really going to cause some unnecessary damage to the current environment when we're trying to recover. And I guess with that, the concerns that we have around the TVL is, again, staying competitive in a tax environment that is already not in parallel or even better than anyone else, but also as we've seen some of the variables that have arrived as a result of the short-term licensing scheme, we don't have perhaps a lot of confidence that the same would apply.
Can I just come in on that? Because I mean, I live in Orkney. I know a number of people that run B&B. Some of them are actually getting out of the the sector. There's been a lot of confusion about you know, the processes. There's been a disparity on cost. It's meant to be revenue neutral, but quite clearly, you know, certain councils are charging more than others. I mean, firstly, do you think that the scheme will be able to be delivered given the procedures that have to take place, the checks that have to take place by the deadlines? Do you think that the councils will be able to deliver that? And also, what are your concerns for the sector? Because fewer B&Bs mean fewer people being able to find accommodation. We've already got problems around hotels, particularly in the Highlands and Islands, as we've experienced over the summer. You know, is that going to be less available space for people to come and spend money locally at a time when, you know, tourism is going to be so key to many of those communities?
In the first part of your question around the ability for a local authority to deliver on the administration of the scheme and the disparity in prices, I think Orkney, for recollection, is about £208, I think, and then you come up to Edinburgh, which is about £5,100 for a 20. Okay, admittedly, it's a larger property. I think on Saturday there were only 19 local authorities that were ready in the collection process, or actually had opened the door. The publication of the guidance was only issued at 11:57 on the 29th of, on the 30th of September, for a start on the 1st of October. There will be a surge. Obviously, those operators who are currently legitimate and want to trade and take bookings with surety will apply now. And I guess it's how do the local authority administrations manage that process? There's a big question around that as well. But we've already seen, you know, there is already evidence, which the Association of Self-Caterers have reported on, of businesses choosing not to trade. I think probably some of it's a bit too much for them. But we have to have a proposition, and we have to have a blend of offering. We've got some great hotel asset. We've got, you know, some new builds as well. So there's plenty there. But if we don't have the right balance, then we're going to be stretched to attract the right market as well. So, and the Fringe, I think, the festival of certainly in Edinburgh, you know, highlighted concerns around a shortfall in accommodation at, you know, key times of the year. I think Scottish Rugby Union also have got a bit of a view on that as well. So difficult. And I guess, you know, about the neutrality of the cost piece is, again, the questionable one, and it goes back to my comments around the TVL process, should it arrive.
Absolutely, and very briefly, thanks.
Yes, all of those things. UK Hospitality is very involved in the deposit return scheme, trying to get members ready for it going live on the 16th of August next year. It's a very ambitious scheme. It's, you know, going to completely change the way that we recycle here in Scotland. I think there's a lot of concern about the length of time that that remains to actually make the scheme operable. I think there's perhaps a sense of, you know, people hoping for the best on this, and that we could actually go live next August, and the scheme is not completely bolted down. One of the big risks is lack of awareness amongst businesses at the moment, and there are cost implications for businesses. Some of my larger members I've been speaking to, they're saying it's going to take them 6 months end to end to for their project team to get everything ready across all of the sites that that they own and they operate. At the kind of smaller scale, there are businesses concerned about where they're actually going to keep all this valuable empty stock until it's collected, because, you know, obviously it's a significant loss to the business if items go missing. So there's some very real difficulties and challenges there. And because of everything else that businesses are facing at the moment, many owners just don't have the headspace to actually really think this through in terms of what they need from that. I was on a call with Lorna Slater last week, again sort of outlining these issues, but saying that, you know, we are committed to, you know, recycling and, you know, net zero agenda, and that we will sort of, you know, continue to promote the scheme to our members so that they are ready. But it's coming down the track really, really quickly, and there's still too many businesses that don't know enough about it and just can't sort of give the necessary headspace to the scheme. That's a problem. Mark's obviously highlighted the local visitor levy as well. It was to some dismay that we saw that in the programme for government. Officials and ministers are very clear that this won't appear until 2026 at the earliest, but as Mark's highlighted, we've got a sentiment issue there, because once all this starts to go out into the public domain, people will be, you know, looking at their newspapers and deciding not to come to Edinburgh because there's a tourist tax, or not to come to Scotland because there's a tourist tax in place. And whilst Edinburgh might want to be the first city in the UK to introduce a tourist tax, it's not always the best thing to go first. So I think that we could have some significant challenges in terms of sentiment and perception at a time when, you know, we've got people looking for value for money, you know, more than ever. So that's an issue. Mark sort of highlighted obviously single use cups and so on. I mean, it's unclear as to when that might actually appear, but again, it's something else that businesses will have to grapple with, another cost for somebody. And there's the health agenda as well. There's calorie labelling, which is kind of still there, which has been introduced in England. Likely it will be introduced here in Scotland at some point in the next year or two, and also sort of activity around nutrition and the promotion of foods with high salt, fat and sugar contents as well, which obviously impact on hospitality businesses too. So it's the weight of all of this which is, you know, causing the big burden. But there are some very real costs to businesses in this as well. I was speaking to Edinburgh Hotels about the visitor levy and what that would mean. You know, I mean, they will have setup costs to manage that. They'll have IT costs to change systems. Some of these will be one-off costs, some of these will be recurring costs. There's also concerns about credit card charges on transactions and things as well. So, I mean, all of these things need to be discussed and bottomed out. But as things stand at the moment, there's no financial recompense being discussed for businesses who have to shoulder these costs. I mean, you know, obviously, ultimately, it will be the visitor who pays the levy for the transaction. But there are some business costs in there.
Okay. Just before I bring in Colin Beattie, can I ask, because you mentioned the national insurance cut would be about £10,000 a year. The UK government say they've sold this as it's committed to a low tax, high growth economy, that it would give businesses the right conditions to drive investment, growth and productivity. As a result of the tax cut, businesses will have more money to invest in becoming more productive, pay higher wages, create more jobs and support the overall growth of the UK economy. That's not what that £10,000 is going to be useful for this year, it doesn't appear.
It will go into sort of, you know, sort of filling the gaps, which are there. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, I'll bring in Colin Beattie to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. I'll maybe direct my first question to Brian Simpson. We're all aware of the announcement by the UK government in terms of support for energy costs. And the comment's already been made by witnesses that we're seeing an effort which is far short of what the COVID exercise was in a similar crisis. How confident are you that the sector is going to be able to support its workers through the cost of living crisis?
Confident at all. If we go by the way hospitality workers in particular were treated during the pandemic, enormous job losses, according to Forth, which is the most used HR platform in the industry. The workforce shrank by 26% between 2020 and 2021, going into 2022. 26% would equate to 58,000 job losses in the hospitality industry in Scotland. That could be, and as my colleagues have pointed out, could be eclipsed by the cost of living crisis, because you've got a toxic combination of price rises for both the workers themselves and the businesses that employ them. It really is cataclysmic. We're already starting to see, as I said, over the last 6 months, impact on reduction in hours. We're seeing, because of the shortfall in customers, we're seeing less tips. People aren't paying by cash. So due to a number of reasons, workers are not getting the tips that they used to rely on. All of that is having a knock-on effect on those workers who, as I say, you know, their average wage, say, being £19,000-£20,000 a year, cannot afford the £2,500 price cap. So it's a double whammy for them for that. But I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, Brian, you mentioned about during COVID there was about a 26% drop in the number employed in the hospitality industry. Did any of that get picked up post COVID? In other words, did it come back up the employment level?
It did. If I can be frank, a lot of it was through fire and rehire. So a lot of multinational hotels, they terminated their employees during the pandemic, despite the job retention scheme. There was a large hotel chain that shall remain nameless for the purposes of this committee, who terminated 95% of their workforce in Glasgow and Edinburgh at three flagship hotels. They engaged them 3 months later. By the way, they terminated them using obviously public funding in terms of their redundancy packages, and then re-engaged them on lesser terms. So that obviously doesn't apply to all employers. There are small employers out there who are genuinely unable to retain their staff. But during the pandemic, a lot of multinational employers who absolutely could have afforded to keep their staff on terminated them and then re-engaged them. So yes, the numbers will have gone up. I don't have the facts on that in terms of how many would have been re-engaged. From our campaign against fire and rehire, we estimate that around 14,000 of those 58,000 were re-engaged, or we campaigned for them to be re-engaged either on furlough or on 100% of their wages.
Mark, can I ask you maybe to comment on the same thing about how you believe the sector will be able to support its workers through the cost of living crisis? How capable is the industry of that?
I think it's a challenge, and again, it's about making sure the business is still there to be able to continue to provide employment for the longer term. Just picking up on Brian's point, of that 58,000, I think a number of those were European workers who also returned back to Europe as well. So even though they may have taken the furlough payment and actually not come back into the marketplace. And there are really good efforts and good examples of employers who are doing their utmost to and being very creative, trying to retain staff up on the west coast of Scotland. There's a hotel company who I know is actually contributing towards the employees' own home domestic fuel bills, as part of the benefits package, over and above, obviously, the meals and the accommodation and everything else they get. But not everybody can afford to do this. So, and the risk is where we are having to look at a balance of closure. They will do the right thing through a process of having to let the employee go, but ultimately they would love to stay open and trade and keep that employee in situ, because so many of them have invested significantly in the employee skills programme over the course of the last 2 years. We had some great funding from Scottish Government to run the Tourism and Hospitality Talent Programme, which I think 3,500 colleagues have gone through that programme. So, if they're not able to stay in employment, then that is a challenge. But again, well-known businesses I've heard from in the Central Belt who quite simply the employees couldn't afford to get to work, and they had to give up their contract. It wasn't the hotel dismissing them in any way, shape or form. It was actually the employee making the decision that they physically cannot afford to pay the transport fuel costs to drive to and from work. Now, that's obviously, in certain parts of the country, not necessarily in Scotland. But we need to have a workforce we need to invest in our future workforce and grow it so we can service the demand and deliver on the expectation of the future customer.
Now, Brian's mentioned a couple of times now about workers moving on to reduced hours. Do you recognise that as an issue at the moment?
Can I suggest maybe we move on, if Leon would like to answer that question? It means all the panels have an opportunity before I bring in Maggie Chapman. Thank you.
I was asking Mark, but okay, Leon.
Yeah, no, happy to answer that. Yeah, I mean, the what we've been seeing is businesses, scaling back their operations for a number of months now, whether that's actually limiting the service that they provide, whether it's actually closing their doors for 1 or 2 days a week. So this is something that businesses have been grappling with for quite some time. I know businesses that have been trying to sort of ensure that the workforce that they do have are still getting the hours or close to the hours that they need. But I mean, clearly with businesses in a precarious situation, there's only so much that they can do. As Mark has highlighted, there are businesses who are looking at sort of what else they can do to support their staff just now. And there are good examples of businesses providing extra time off for staff so that they can benefit from wellness days, and also people looking at sort of how they can be more imaginative with the shift patterns and so on as well to ensure that there's still work there for the people that they employ. But one of the challenges that we are facing is that because businesses are in a difficult situation just now, we're beginning to see, obviously, workers beginning to kind of move away from hospitality again to look for other types of employment. And also some of the costs now that that workers are facing, particularly in rural areas, means that it is quite a challenge, financial stretch for them to actually get to their place of employment.
Leon, my own personal experience is that there are many hospitality businesses who seem to be crying out for staff, who are desperate for staff with the skills to fill key jobs. And yet, on the other side of the coin, we hear that, in fact, there's reduction of hours in some areas of the hospitality sector. How does that work out?
Well, it's a very...
Sorry, could I ask a brief response
then I'll move on to Margaret Chapman.
Well, it's a very broad sector, and you really kind of need to also break it down by sort of geography as well, because the challenges that some businesses are facing are not necessarily faced by all in terms of staffing shortages and levels of demand. But I mean, the general picture is one of diminishing demand and therefore kind of fewer hours available.
Thank you. Maggie Chapman, to be followed by... Thanks very much, Ken. Thank you, panel, for your comments so far this morning. I'm going to follow on the same theme from Colin's questions around job security and, I suppose, job availability. And we've heard about that tension between workers wanting the hours and hours and shifts not being available. I suppose, Leon, you said that... it's a diverse sector and they're geographical and probably other separations. So how then are you as an organisation engaging with your members? What are the focuses that you are working on to deal with those differences in geography, in marginality in that? Because obviously job security as a whole doesn't tell us everything we need to know.
Sure. Yeah, so, I mean, from a workforce point of view, I mean, we see this as being sort of absolutely critical to the ambitions of the sector. I mean, we came out of the pandemic when, as Brian has highlighted, we'd lost a lot of the workforce. A few weeks ago, we were still sort of looking at sort of, you know, very high levels of vacancy rates across the sector. One of the things that we're trying to do is to sort of encourage businesses to, pay more to, you know, attract in and recruit the staff, and to offer more flexibility around working as well. There are also issues around sort of productivity too, where businesses who are maybe struggling with staff or finding that they need fewer staff can, you know, change the way that they're working, but, you know, still sort of provide that job security for the workforce. Longer term, you know, when we come through this current set of challenges, it will be that we will need to have access to, you know, that skilled workforce in order for businesses to develop and grow and play their full part in the economy of the country again. But just now, I mean, it's a real challenge for, you know, SMEs in particular, mm-hmm. to, you know, keep a full complement of staff if they are not seeing the demand coming through from consumers.
Okay, thank you. Mark, if I can move to you, I suppose a similar line of questioning, but if we look at, Leon's talked about the geographical variations, if I can ask you to pick up on the variations in size and the relative differences of what larger organisations, larger companies are doing compared to the smaller businesses specifically around job security and so therefore what that means for targeted support or you know, to ensure job security not only through this coming season, which is going to be very difficult, but beyond that as well.
Sure. I mean, there's a couple of other things, if I can just come back mm-hmm. to what Leon said. City centres, we've still got a huge amount of people working at home. There's a culture now of not going out onto the high street, and obviously there are a huge number of small hospitality operators, pubs, coffee shops, etc., who have seen a massive downturn in their trading, and that has resulted obviously in them having to cut their cloth according to workers' hours as well. So, you know, that's another challenge we face, and it's important to have the vibrancy piece. There's lots of good activity being done around at local level through the local hotels associations together, working. Inverness is a great example where not a lot of people on the ground to come into the industry. They've gone into the schools. They've worked as a collective to bring absolutely raw young talent with no experience whatsoever into the business to train them and give them that on-job learning experience and actually create that community amongst the workforce. There's a lot more being done by Springboard and the broader tourism skills group. We have Apprentice and Hospitality Scotland as well, which is a great initiative where, again, a number of large operators and small have come in supporting apprentices into their business. And using those generation of people, those workforce, to be advocates as well. And, you know, we've also now, with the cost of living crisis, also seeing the older worker looking for a secondary income. And again, it's positioning the opportunities of employment to that older workforce too. So as Leon touched on earlier, you know, many of the operators are changing their modus operandi around shift patterns and actually seeing, you know, the old traditional ways of perhaps working going, and how do we adapt to the modern day way of working. We have the Hoteliers Charter, which was launched 2 years ago during COVID to try and present the industry in a much better light around highlighting the opportunities that exist, but also about the values of fair work within the business. And I was just saying to Brian earlier, next 17th of October, you will see a UK-wide campaign called Hospitality Rising being launched. And that is a campaign that has raised nearly £850,000 worth of private sector money from operators, again, to change the sort of perception of the industry, but also to, I suppose, make it a bit cooler in terms of the campaign, the marketing campaign, and be heavily targeted to people under the sort of 30 age bracket. But that's the industry mm-hmm. taking ownership, and small operators, medium-sized operators are very much part and parcel of that.
Okay, thanks. Brian, if I can come to you and talk a little bit about the, I suppose, what else as Unite you're looking for from the employers around. We've heard about, you know, paying appropriately and flexibility and that kind of thing. What are the other kinds of things that employers could be looking at, and how are you finding those discussions going when you're having those with employers to attract and retain people in hospitality, never mind the issues around job security? And I suppose the final bit of that is, what are the kinds of things that, as we this is part of our pre-budget scrutiny, what are the kinds of things that we should be requiring as part of our budget discussions?
Thanks, Maggie. First of all, job security, particularly in this cost of living crisis, is a number one priority for Unite. It is our top priority to ensure well-paid, you know, secure, contractually secure and unionised jobs throughout hospitality. That's our modus operandi. We are more than happy, as I've said to Mark and Leon, to work with the industry to drive up standards, because there is a vested interest there. One of the things that I think, one of the things we are doing specifically is we have our own Fair Hospitality Charter, which I'm sure chimes in a lot of ways with the Fair Hotels Charter, which is really simple reforms, things like the real living wage. To be honest, it's the Scottish Business Pledge. It's the real living wage, ensuring a huge reduction, if not complete removal, of zero-hour contracts, providing proactive sexual harassment policies to protect women workers, transport home after 11 o'clock at night so that they're not, you know, having to pay the £12 that they've earned in tips to pay for a taxi home. These are all things that particularly multinational employers can adopt with actually quite low costs. But the benefits of that, and I'm not here to make the benefits for businesses or to make the benefit points for businesses, but, you know, my colleagues would agree, hopefully, that that's how you reduce turnover, to drive up standards, to keep those workers, to keep, without being elitist about it, to keep the most highly skilled workers. We surveyed over 800 chefs about a year ago. 48% of them said that they'd already left the industry or they were about to leave the industry. Now, that is, again, without wishing to be elitist, the most highly skilled, most highly trained employees within the industry. If almost 50% of them are leaving, and I would guess that that's gone up again, we're just about to get the results of this year's survey, I think that's gone up. In terms of specifically what the Scottish Government can do with the budget, I think we need a similar furlough scheme. We need a scheme that will protect workers from the cost of living crisis, whether that be mitigation brought through the Barnett consequential. I'm not an economist. What I know is that any amount of money that's either given directly to businesses or directly to workers, it needs to be conditional. We cannot have a situation where huge multinational employers are receiving, you know, hundreds of thousands in tax breaks or whatever, but they're allowed to fire and rehire. Public money should be conditional. It should be conditional upon the Scottish Business Pledge. Any money that has been given directly to businesses, there must be a conditionality clause that says you must pay the living wage. You must retain your workers if you're getting £120,000 in tax breaks or direct financial support. For me, that's an absolute necessity.
Can I just come back? Yeah. One of the things we put this in our, I'm just going to wave this around because somebody asked me to. In the document here, one of the most successful interventions and support that we got from Scottish Government during COVID was the money to support the Tourism and Hospitality Talent Programme, which came at a time through COVID where many people were out of work. Mental health was obviously at the highest. We need to upskill and continue to invest and upskill a workforce that is shrunken, to say the least, and it will take time to recover. So an ongoing investment to investing in the skills piece. So if there is temporary displacement of an employee or otherwise, there is a place where they can go and can still continue to further and develop their skill sets. So we would strongly recommend that. We've got a shortfall in skills in certain parts, but at the same time, there's a proven mechanism that's delivered really, really positive responses. And the 3,500 people have gone through it, I think, would be strong advocates for more of the same.
Thank you. Thank you. Colin Smith to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good afternoon to the panel. Can I pick up the point earlier about labour and skill shortages? Because for some time now, everywhere I go and I speak to businesses, they tell me they can't recruit, that there's a huge labour and skill shortage. Today, though, we're being told there's obviously businesses that are cutting staff and cutting hours and restricting hours. So there's almost a kind of a contradiction there. So it's clearly more complex than it's just a labour and skill shortage, or it's just everybody's cutting back. So can you say a bit more, maybe Leon and Mark, about specifically the types of business, that the sectors, I suppose, the geography of those businesses that are the ones that are laying off staff effectively and cutting hours most, obviously. So in other words, what are the businesses that are in need of that support most? Because obviously some are still saying we can't recruit at the moment, we want to expand, but clearly others are really struggling. So what specifically are those businesses that are struggling and who needs the help most?
I'll go first. Yeah. So, I mean, it's, as we came out of COVID, it was pretty clear that we had a massive shortfall. We were estimating somewhere in the region of 30,000 vacancies across the sector that businesses were trying to fill. That has continued, and what has happened is we've now also got, and people have, you know, gone very far in order to recruit and retain staff. We've obviously touched on some of the good work that businesses are doing in that space. So to some extent, businesses were able to fill some of the shortages that they had. But, you know, the difficulty is that in some parts of the country, there just isn't the working age population to draw from. So that's a major challenge, particularly for businesses in rural and coastal locations, and obviously wasn't helped by Brexit either. So for those businesses, they were already sort of, you know, moving to models where they were only opening, you know, some of the time, you know, maybe closing one or two days or reducing the service that they were offering. So rural hotels would only be offering meals and bar service to residents. They wouldn't be able to be open for non-residents and so on. So, I mean, a lot of those businesses are still grappling with those challenges, and they've grappled with those challenges over the summer whilst demand has actually been there. Cities, slightly different picture, because as Mark was saying, you know, there's not the same level of footfall and activity in our cities that was there pre-COVID. We haven't seen the kind of business visitor market recover, which is so crucial for places like Aberdeen and so on. So whilst they were still sort of, you know, trying to find skilled staff, they didn't have necessarily the kind of same levels of demand that they needed to service as well. So it's a mixed picture in terms of where we were in the summer, but things have moved on massively since then. Now we're looking at a situation where demand is very light, and that's particularly for hotels, particularly in kind of rural and coastal areas. There's probably going to be a bit of a kind of drop off there. Cities are still struggling to come back. You know, we are sort of in a situation where, you know, there will be winter festivals and so on, which will hopefully attract people to come in to and visit Scotland. A lot of that, you know, will be sort of, you know, taking place in Edinburgh and maybe other cities too. But just now, businesses are just not kind of seeing the kind of demand that they really need in order to even sort of maintain, you know, some of the staffing levels that they've been operating at over the last few months.
Matt wants to add anything to that?
I think, I mean, we're talking specifically about skills, we've lost all of our language skill set with the departure of our European colleagues, and obviously it's a big market for us. We need to have that cultural the blend of a cultural workforce. We're an international industry. We should have a fully multinational workforce to be able to match the needs of the customer as well. And not only that, that's a really good. They're very important to our own homegrown talent as well. So how they can learn too. So there's a skills lacking there. The supply chain, mustn't forget that. You know, if there's breaks in the supply chain, we can't do anything at the front end. So the need to have the logistics workers there, the fruit pickers, and all of the others that we know have in the food production space have been challenged with. But I think that the other point is around, and one of the benefits going back to this development programme, so we lost a lot of our middle management, our supervisory staff. So when you're onboarding a new recruit into the industry, some of those raw recruits, it's very difficult, again, if you're challenged with trying to service a guest, of not having that supervisory level of well placed individual to onboard that new recruit into the workplace as you would want them to, so they stick around and stay and they can learn. So the investment right the way through supervisory management and then leadership is really key. And I think, you know, we know we've got accommodation challenges still in certain parts of the country, which limit the amount of opportunity for a business to retain staff in a downtime as well. There's a cost associated with that. And then from outside looking in, the uncertainty of the sector's long-term sort of recovery is obviously not going to perhaps fare too well if you're looking at a career in the industry and an industry that is maybe, you know, susceptible to potentially having to slow down or close. So a combination of things, but you know, for us, I think language is a massive shortfall, and that's why we need to get the immigration position shifted so we can get those international workers back into the ecosystem, as much for servicing the customer but also for our own talent to learn and engage with them too.
Can I just come in 1 minute to give an example from our perspective of the antidote to this labour shortage? It would come as no surprise to members that we believe that the antidote to that is driving up standards. But just to give you one example, especially in rural communities, we teamed up with a small hotel, a 40-bedroom hotel in Dunkeld, which had really been struggling post-Brexit and then through COVID to retain, to attract anyone. Not because they'd done anything wrong, they hadn't terminated any staff, they actually paid 100% furlough, or they topped up the furlough to 100% of wages during the pandemic, and still they were struggling to retain staff. So we teamed up with them, we eventually, piece by piece, incrementally got them to implement the Fair Hospitality Charter, the final one being paying the real living wage, and they started paying £10.50 an hour. Within 6 weeks, they had filled their labour shortage. Because of the, you know, we helped to advertise, it was top story news in STV, because we want to advertise decent employers. Those employers that are doing the right thing and paying the real living wage and not terminating people unnecessarily, putting in place a proactive sexual harassment policy, happen to be those with the lowest turnovers, those who were able to fill those gaps in employment. So I think that example, which is replicated in so many other examples, particularly in rural Scotland, speaks for itself in terms of the antidote to that shortage.
Can I just follow up on that point, Brian? That's very interesting, and Leon and Mark, that was really helpful in terms of trying to break down that challenge in labour and supply chains. It does seem to me, though, that, I mean, it clearly is very complex, Brian, because you mentioned earlier, obviously, there are a lot of businesses that are absolutely on the brink, especially hospitality, the licensed trade, are really, really struggling, and that's having a big impact on your members who are seeing their hours cut. But you also mentioned that some businesses, especially particularly large businesses, were very much profiteering from COVID and the cost of living crisis. And I know Unite have done quite a lot of work on this and been highlighting that there does seem to be, amongst, I say, very big business, price gouging, where the businesses are effectively driving up prices above supply costs, and that in turn is spiralling inflation. Can you say a little bit about that work Unite have done and just what the impact that has on the cost of living?
Yeah, absolutely. Again, not to just be focusing on multinational hotel chains, but it is them that we're seeing that, the biggest examples of that. Take COP26, for example. Obviously, most accommodation services were increasing their prices, but you had multinational employers who were charging £500-600 per room per night. None of that extra profit was going back to the workforce. We used that price increase as an example to campaign for higher wages. None of it was trickling down to the workforce. In fact, the hotel in question that was a five-star, you don't need to do much research to know who I'm talking about here, the five-star hotel in Glasgow, which had was charging as much as £700 per night, but still had housekeepers cleaning those rooms on £7 and £8 per hour. Some of them are still being paid youth rates, so they were being paid below the minimum wage. Unfortunately, that is perfectly legal. They weren't breaching the Minimum Wage Act, but that is an example of where literally the workers who were cleaning those £600-700 a night rooms had no increase in wages whatsoever. They actually had their hours cut. Some of them had their hours cut to zero. They were put on zero-hour contracts. That was going on during the pandemic. It's still going on during the cost of living crisis. And unfortunately, it happens to be the employers who could actually afford to pay a bit more. We're not talking about small businesses. Yes, there's small businesses that have had to let people go. There's small businesses that have cut hours. And I can't speak for every example, but by and large, the employers who are doing this to the most workers happen to be those with the deepest pockets.
Come back in there. I think you'll probably be aware there's a Fair Work inquiry into the hospitality sector, which we're all very involved with, and we're delighted to be part of that. And the point that Brian makes around real living wage employers is, there's a really vastly increasing number of real living wage employers in the industry now, and probably many more that pay but above that but don't necessarily declare themselves. The new Virgin Hotel here in Edinburgh, 225 rooms, is a real living wage employer. You look at Mercat Tours, you look at Rabbi's Tours, great examples where those staff are very much in situ, retained, and the attraction is there. But I'll take another, probably one of Scotland's most well-known hotels, and I'll leave you to in the Central Belt, who have also paid way above the base wage for the sake of 50p an hour more from another type of business in a different sector. You've got individuals who are leaving and going to take and chase that money because they need the extra 50p to combat the rising costs that they're having to face in their own home. So it's a small pool that we're all fishing in, and every sector of the economy is also chasing the same, chasing that person. And as little as 50p is a point of difference.
Okay, I'm going to bring in Gordon MacDonald, followed by Fiona.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. I was wanting to ask you about cost of living and what the impact and what the outlook is going forward. Leon, you touched upon the fact that hospitality is a very broad area, and it covers pubs, restaurants, cafes, travel and tourism businesses, entertainment venues. So this cost of living crisis, it's reducing the amount of leisure spend that people have. Is it having the same impact across all of these different areas within the hospitality sector, or is it some benefiting from?
Again, it's very variable. I mean, talking to pubs and restaurants, I mean, they're seeing a decline in footfall generally, and they're also seeing a decline in spend, you know, sort of, you know, people spending less money whilst they're actually out, whilst they're actually in the venues. People appear to be going out less often than they were before, which is understandable given that people are obviously looking at their personal finances and you know, working out how they're going to make things stretch. So hospitality is very much on the front line when it comes to people scaling back on their discretionary spend. I think what we're starting to see now with the bookings for hotels is that people are scaling back on those sort of mini breaks, those weekends away, which has obviously provided, you know, a lot of business to hospitality over the years, you know, particularly hotels and other forms of accommodation. But we're starting to see that being scaled back as well. It may be that people, you know, continue to sort of, you know, ring fence that kind of 2 week holiday, which means it's going to be absolutely vital that we encourage people to holiday in Scotland, you know, people who are residents, people in the rest of the UK, and obviously going after those kind of lucrative markets as well, which Mark highlighted before. So we're seeing that kind of sort of gradual sort of, you know, downturn in spend. People are looking for, you know, they still want to have a good experience, they still want to go out, but it's becoming increasingly difficult for businesses to provide that experience at the kind of price point that people are looking for. So businesses are absorbing a lot of those additional costs themselves at the moment, which is obviously completely unsustainable, but they need to do that, it seems, in order to keep the customers coming that they do have.
And I'll come to you, Leon, and then Mark, but in terms of staycationers, there was a suggestion that the summer we've just passed, there was a large increase in staycationers, so people might have been spending less, but there was more of them, and it was partially due to the weak pound making foreign holidays more expensive, travel disruption, etc. So, I mean, what impact did staycationers have on businesses, and did Scotland get the share of, I think the estimate was 26 million staycationers?
So, I mean, we're very fortunate in Scotland that we're actually able to attract, you know, a variety of visitors from, you know, across the rest of the UK and internationally as well. And obviously the staycation market has been absolutely kind of crucial, particularly over the last few years. The issue is that people do come and they do spend less. I mean, that's a major challenge. I think that whilst, you know, we did have you know, strong domestic market, we did see a lot of people going out as well. They were sort of prepared to brave the queues at the airports and head out for their sort of 2 weeks in the sun and so on, particularly after sort of 2 years of, you know, having, you know, severe travel restrictions. So the domestic market, you know, has been key, is key. A lot of businesses, you know, they can't necessarily pivot very easily towards the international market. They're relying on the domestic market. That's their real bread and butter stuff. But, you know, it is the international market which is, you know, particularly lucrative. Now, as we go into, you know, further into the cost of living crisis, it's becoming more and more apparent that we are being affected here in the UK, you know, perhaps to a greater extent than other countries. So we'll probably see the domestic market sort of tailing off, particularly on those sort of, you know, shorter breaks in particular. But we will see more interest from the international markets, particularly with the pound being weak. So it's absolutely vital that we chase those key markets.
Okay, Mark?
So, I mean, from a domestic market, I think the secondary spend piece is huge. So looking at the broader tourism industry, if you take visitor attractions or where you go and you, or even if you're going to a resort hotel and you're paying for extras, you know, if you go as a family, one of the reasons is to go there is because your kids want to do X, Y, and Z. Mm. And all of a sudden, you know, if you can't do that, then you've got probably a bigger challenge on you with your kids biting your head off rather than going there. So people choose not to go. So, again, a lot of evidence now of taking the picnic and driving, going to the great outdoors, which is fantastic, and you'll see, you know, that self-curation of your holidays. So the bottle of wine's become the glass of wine and all of that stuff. And all of that little extra, of course, you're competing against other types of activities. You know, we look at the return of the football season, the tickets. Mm. We've had an amazing season of outdoor live music. A lot of that has been thanks to COVID in some respects because of a backlog of touring artists. So I think Jeff Ellis sold over 1 million tickets to concerts over the summer season. Now, they're not cheap. And again, you're making a commitment to a bucket list type experience. So that then puts something else on the back burner. The cost of physically putting petrol in the car and travelling from A to B is also a consideration now. So the compound effect of that is again, getting people to think twice. The outbound tourism spike we knew would happen. I mean, I think those that we probably captured were the ones who saw the chaos in the airports down south and hadn't made that commitment and thankfully supported. The golf tourism season was phenomenal with the amount of golf we had played in Scotland, but a lot of that was overhang as well. So I don't think we've had a true picture of what the real numbers are this year, but again, from a survey the Association of Self-Caterers have just published today, they have themselves shown a significant slowdown in bookings, and it's last-minute decisions, more couples than families as well, and the one market that has actually come back quite well was the coach market as well. So there was a lot of tourers of the older community who were able to have that confidence restored about travelling in that way too, but don't spend a lot.
And how does the industry, how are they planning going forward? Do they imagine that this constraint in consumer spending is going to be ongoing for a long period of time, or are they hoping it changes in a shorter period of time? And you know, what impact is that going to have on the industry?
Yeah. As a sector, pre-COVID, we were around 65% domestic dependent anyway, and 35% international. Mm. You know, I think we'll all say it's absolutely critical that we have a much upweighted international footfall and capture the opportunity while it's here, make sure that we increase the routes and the connectivity. You know, we've seen a peg back in the Middle Eastern carriers. You know, we need to restore that connection, and we need to obviously make sure that we capitalise on the US market. So it was the UK inbound conference last week in Aberdeen, and again, the operators there would tell you that there is demand, and Scotland obviously is a very attractive destination to come, but we have to shore up the quality, make sure the assets are here, and actually make sure that the infrastructure and that the transport routes are absolutely rock solid. Tourism Ireland, you know, invested €80 million into their international marketing campaigns and to make sure that they maintain that. And there is our competition, you know, not so far away from here. So the investment, and it was one of the, going back to the convener's first point around the recovery piece, you know, around how do we must invest in growing our international footfall. Average spend is about £650 of an international tourist as opposed to 150 odd from a domestic market. So, and that will allow then the footfall and the reinvestment into the product.
Okay,
thanks
very much.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to bring Fiona Hislop in. We are moving now to questions that are more focused on pre-budget scrutiny. So I think Fiona's questions will be looking for suggestions about the budget statement that is next. That once we come back off October, and the committee's working this.
The convener's just asked my question.
Sorry.
We're getting down to brass tacks, looking forward to the budget of 23-24. Thank you for your written evidence. I think you've set out clearly what your asks and expectations would be. We understand from the Chancellor there's likely to be departmental cuts at UK level. We don't know what, depending on which departments they are, what that will mean in terms of Barnett consequentials. So we could be facing a budget, and very likely to face a budget, that is tighter this year than it is or has been. So what I'm going to ask you is, what would you prioritise for keeping? This is not about additional spend. Is what's important to you and your sector in the budget that is already there that you would want to prioritise to keep? And I'll maybe come to Leon first and then to Mark.
In terms of what's already there, I mean, we've talked a lot about the need to keep promoting Scotland as a leading destination. So I think we really need to keep, you know, the budget there and high for Visit Scotland, both promoting the country and promoting destinations around the country as well. That's absolutely key and critical. We need to keep investing in infrastructure as well. We've obviously got sort of, you know, significant challenges with some of our some of our transportation, and I know members on the islands have had, you know, a pretty torrid time of it. We need to be able to turn that around for them and also for communities there. So I think investment in ferries absolutely key. We need to continue to be able to kind of look at sort of spreading the benefits of tourism and hospitality around the country. So, rail, bus services and so on, absolutely key and critical and vital as part of that. So I think we should really be looking at sort of, you know, is there some possibility there of kind of turning on the tap for a bit more investment in those areas. We've talked a lot about people. I mean, ultimately, when we come through this crisis, it will be about having the right people to come into the sector and deliver that great experience that visitors and guests are looking for. So it's certainly be looking for the Scottish Government to continue to invest in activities which support tourism and hospitality, pushing for a greater awareness and understanding of the great jobs and careers in the sector, and encourage people to actively come in to the sector, and also to help us sort of upweight some of the skills activity for people who are currently in the sector as well. So I would see those as kind of priorities.
Mark?
It's great when you double act and we have a council that comes together to develop the same budget, or pre-budget positioning. Without question, we have to maintain our position in terms of being a competitive destination and one that's an attractive one to visit. And that also, you then need to create the enablers for people to get here. And that infrastructure piece is critical. Scotland Outlook 2030, the new tourism and hospitality industry leadership group, which I've been invited to co-chair with Ivan McKee, is about to reform itself and with a new membership, and will kick off towards the end of this year. And I guess the priority actions for that group will come out, but I don't see them being any different. So to the point around, you know, making sure that Visit Scotland's budget isn't compromised in any way, that it can continue to do what they do very well. But also on top of that, there is the Destination Net Zero agenda and how do businesses transition through to their green agenda. And that we need to have the right, support networks in place to support the industry to do that. There's a lot of investment being made by the larger corporates, but some of the smaller operators are struggling to do that, and how do they go next? The skills work, the investment in skilled workforces continues on, and that NSET agenda, I guess, that community wealth building, Scotland Outlook is all about spreading that tourism wealth, and how do we make that happen? So, it's difficult. The budget is very, very tight, and we know that. But I think we would ask that the government see, the sector as a force for good, and actually it drives a multitude of benefits through local economies. When the one thing that COVID did do favourably for the sector is when it stopped, I think there was a much greater recognition of just how important tourism is to the local community and how many livelihoods it impacted by it not actually happening. So don't see it as I have said this before to Ivan McKee and others. There's a lot of talk about future industries. We've been around for a long, long time as an industry, and people will always eat, drink and want to have a holiday. And actually the impact as a force for good that tourism delivers is something that shouldn't be underestimated.
So if it reassures you, the fact that the Economy Committee of the Parliament is, for the second time, has focused on tourism, perhaps reflects our understanding that this is a national industry that reaches one of the few that reaches all parts of Scotland.
I think we've always said we're very fortunate and grateful for the fact that Scottish Government view the sector with the degree of importance that it is to the economy. And we're probably the envy of our colleagues south of the border and elsewhere. So, but the investment in the asset, and again, going back into cities around the vibrancy, how do we bring that sort of buzz and culture and the sort of life blood back into these communities, as much for the well-being of society as well. There is a real need that we can stimulate a lot of jobs too, so we can recover quickly given the right ammunition. But you need to have that investment, that pump prime into you know, those larger operators, the businesses that can really are ambitious. There's a lot of entrepreneurship in the industry. There's been some great examples of small and medium and large scale entrepreneurship that has delivered, who they have ambition and they want to grow. And I think as a collaborative approach, that's what we really want and to encourage and continue the way we've worked previously over the years.
And can maybe come to Brian Simpson now and ask you what you would expect to see in the budget. Now, the same point is, if you want anything new, you might have to say what you'd prefer not to have. And I would ask directly, do you think it's more important to keep some of the good and progressive policies that are already there to help in the skills sector or different other areas that we've just heard about in the previous evidence sessions? Or is there something new that needs to be done? What's missing from the response so far, and not just from the Scottish Government, but from the UK Government as well?
I need to separate those two governments, because my criticism is more barbed, shall we say, for the Westminster Government. But in Scotland, I think the one thing that we need to put more financial and physical, logistical resources into is increasing the focus on fair work and encouraging employers to sign up to the fair work principles, the business pledge. If I can be critical for a moment, I don't feel that fair work is as interwoven in our discussion around business growth or economic success even. I do feel sometimes that fair work is tagged on at the end. And I would say that more money and more resources and more time, ministerial buy-in for fair work is put in there across the piece. Totally agree with Leon about investment in infrastructure. We need better trains and buses to be able to, for the workers to access those rural employers or workplaces, but also for the customers to get up there. In terms of the British government, I mean, I've lost complete faith in their willingness to support not only small businesses but the lowest paid workers in the British economy. Everything from the tax breaks to the richest people in society. I think it was Leon earlier that said that the average small business would gain about £10,000 from the NI cut. The average hospitality worker is gaining about £200. So the actual benefit to them from the so-called changes that are or improvements that are being made at a British-wide level are not touching the sides. So I would say in Scotland, focusing more on fair work, making sure that it's completely interwoven and genuinely resourced across the Scottish economy, not just in hospitality, retail's crying out for it as well, and also agree with Mark on community wealth building. I think that's an important way to put to get more bang for your buck, putting an amount of money into the hands of citizens who will spend it a lot better, frankly, than some politicians.
Can I just come out? Whatever it is, it needs to be meaningful. And I think the challenge is, a lot of the time, is that the level of support in some cases has been great to have, but actually to have real impact, it's not allowed businesses to make transformational change or invest. So clearly the business rates lever is the biggest one that is within the gift of Scottish Government to consider. But when you talk about the size and scale of investments that are needing to be done and go back to being competitive and staying competitive in a modern day world, it has to have scale and meaningful investments to be allowed for businesses to make that transfer, that change. Now, that can be balanced through different fiscal measures or otherwise, but the intent is there by many, the aspiration is certainly there from the industry as a collective, but it's got to be done within the scale of being able to stay viable and open in the short term.
So there's an important message there about there's a value into something that is about how we can have a sustainable sector for individuals as the workforce, and that also helps on knock-on in terms of retention, which has a cost and value itself, but also that investment in growth, not just the kind of short-term immediate issues around energy costs. But I suppose I would just ask finally, if there were Barnett consequentials, it's not obvious that there would be, that were in the business sector area, would business rates be your priority?
Yeah. Number one.
Okay.
With no state aid cap as well, because a lot of the larger businesses, because of the business rates relief, may well get over to the over the tipping point. So there would have to be a caveat there that wouldn't actually, I suppose, exclude some of those large businesses from being able to take the advantage of a relief of that type.
Thank you for your very direct but also thoughtful responses.
Thank you. We have had one statement from the Scottish Government around this year's budget. Within the budget this committee is responsible for, there has been a saving made to the employability budget of the region of £50 million. That has been to partly fund the Scottish Child Payment. So that's a decision the government has made. And in correspondence with us, they have explained that the high employment rate at the moment feels that you could take some money savings out of that budget. I don't know if, Brian, if you have a view on that. Because the government are kind of... I've proposed it as a... I mean, they're not denying it'll have an impact, but they're saying the impact should be minimal because there will still be money in employable budget, but £50 million is coming out. Do you have any concerns about the impact of that?
Concerns over that. £50 million is a huge amount of money, which, if I can be frank, is well spent by organisations like Skills Development Scotland. We work hand-in-hand with Skills Development Scotland to make sure that people are, as Mark pointed out earlier, that we get some of those 58,000 job losses or people who lost their jobs back into much more sustainable employment. I would imagine that's going to have an impact massively on skills development and the employability resources that are there. I think that money can be taken from other areas of the Scottish economy that would have less of an impact on the workers that need it the most.
Okay, thank you. I think that brings us to the close of this session. I'd like to thank witnesses very much for sharing their experience and expertise with us this morning, and we'll now move into private session for the remaining item on the agenda. Thank you.